welcome everybody to the ESE studio. We are very happy to have here today Professor Paul Hugenholz. He is Emeritus Professor of the Rotterdam University, past President of the ESE, and Honorary President of the ESE also. And we are very happy to have him here, and we are going to make two parts in this interview, talk about what was the ESE at the beginning, and the other part will be speak about the fellowship program. So thanks to come here, and my first question will be, why did you choose to study medicine?
Well, first of all, I'd like to say that I'm happy to be here to say a number of things that I thought were important over the past, we say, 50 years of the European society, because it relates to the answer I'm giving you, why did I choose medicine? I chose medicine because it was in the family. My father was, grandfather, and others were before in similar kind of occupation, preachers and so forth. So there was a tendency, and that was very prevalent just after World War II, that if you could do something for community, for humanity, that was the thing to do. And that is basically related to the beginning of the European society, because much later, when I got into contact with Europe again, having been in America for 20 years, it was very clear that what cardiology in Europe was had nothing to do with what I had experienced in America. There you had an American Heart Association, you had the American College of Cardiology, you had various very strong organizations for the science, for the role in the community. We were splintered. And the society that met for the first time in London, as we heard from our president, Komaja, was more a group of, shall we say, specialists coming together in a nice setting. But there was no, shall we say, urge to do something for Europe. And also, the organization was in the hands of a national society. And if it was Brussels, for example, or Holland, it would have been tough job for a small society, few members, to really put up a European effort. So there wasn't. And also the frequency of meetings was once every 4 years. So to me, the real changes happened in 1972 when it was decided that we would try to make a European effort by bringing together all the various nations in one place, not because they were invited at that society or by that society, but it was the logical place to be. And if we make a big jump now, with all our 32,000-33,000 members are coming here, we can only go to Munich, or to Amsterdam, or to Stockholm, or to Barcelona, mm-hmm. and Paris. So that is just over these 50 years, how tremendously the demands changed the venue, changed the attitude, and changed the role of the national societies. So if that is the beginning, you could understand how also, when later we talk about the fellowship, this was intimately related. Because, as I explained to you before, it was clear in 1960, 70, that we had a incipient army of cardiologists on the way. America had shown the way how you should organize it, but we did not have any officers. We had a lot of people in the field, we had no organization. And I think the fellowship, as we'll explain it later, is an integral part of the history of the society because it was meant, and it has, delivered cadre, officers. People who are willing, beyond their daily practice or their daily activities at the university, to give time to the society, mm-hmm. in various roles. And I think that should not be underestimated. We could not have run this society today here the way we do it if we didn't have sufficient chairman who knew what it was about, mm-hmm. and so on and so on.
So the structure of the ESE was completely different from now.
Yeah, it was different, just to repeat it once more, it was dependent on a national society, mm-hmm. and they were the French in Paris, they were the British in London, and they were an effort to try to invite friends from Europe, but it wasn't a representative European activity. And that was started, as I explained to you, in 72, mm-hmm. when we decided to try to make a Congress in a center that was capable of handling our crowds. Also, and that's the second factor, we felt that a European society consisting only of national societies wasn't sufficient to attract the young potential scientist and doctor. Why? Because the tradition in national societies is that you begin at the bottom and you grow up and eventually get in a position that you get chosen as a member of the society, which means that the creative time for a doctor between age 30 and 50, for half of it was not available because you were not recognized in your national society. And that was the beginning of the working groups. The working groups were made to allow young people, once they got out of medical school and into a specialty, to communicate with their age and to communicate with groups throughout Europe. And these working groups were like the horizontal fibers in a tissue, in a weave. The vertical ones were the national societies, and the horizontal ones were the working groups. And the younger people could interact with the older people because the program, such as these, had working group activities and the national societies. I think that was an important part. The next important part, which again relates to the fellowship, was that we felt we would only grow if we allowed other disciplines than just cardiology. So we had to have the physiologists, the basic scientists, and so on and so on. And the more we opened ourselves to the influences from outside, which were very important, think of ultrasound. We would have never gotten a diagnostic tool so fast over 30 years or within 30 years in the hands of an individual cardiologist to replace the electrocardiogram, so to speak, if we hadn't had the science inside. So it's this openness to the, yeah, the border sciences that makes for a very important result. So to sum up, the difference between the situation between 1950 and 1970 was we decreased the importance relative of the nation and we increased the European collaboration. We added to the vertical structures, horizontal structures of the right working groups, and we were open to what we today call the affiliations, the people who make the pacemakers and not only the doctor who places them. And I think this interaction of different and openness from to new ideas is what has made a fundamental contribution to the society as it is today.
Thanks for your complete answer of these questions about the origin of the ESC. Yeah, we can start to talk, I think, about this picture, the fellowship, how it comes.
Well, the picture that you see here is the first, shall we say, parchment document of a fellowship recognition. I'm not going to say that I made it myself, but we had in the beginning 10 made by a, shall we say, calligrapher, handmade. And Professor Kubertus, who was my secretary when I was president, and I decided that we ought to launch it. And so we said, well, how do we do this? Very simple. We appoint each other number one and two. So he, as secretary, signed me as number one from Holland, and I signed myself as chairman of president of the society, and I gave him number two. And I think the idea right at the beginning was not so much to make a mutual admiration society of all the people who give each other recognition, but more that we felt quite urgently that if we had that army of people that was marching on to enter the field of cardiology, cardiovascular surgery, all the related and affiliated professions, we need cadre, we needed officers. Mm-hmm. We needed people who had sufficient experience, so the somewhat older person. We needed people who had experience in research and in running departments or hospital units. We needed people who in their country were recognized by their national societies, and above all, who were willing to give time. And whether the time became, say, a chairmanship of a session such as here, or to write the guidelines, or to enter in committees, all of these are the goals that ultimately in front of us were coming at us and for which we needed people. And that was the beginning of the fellowship. So what do I say today? In 2012, I say to the young man, to me young man, of around 40, 45, do give some time to your society. We are not here only to be, and that is our first goal, to be a profession of competent specialists in a field, working with our hands, with our brain. But we're also a society in which we have to collaborate to the point that we provide guidelines to the younger people, we provide guidelines to the governments. We have to give the information we have available to the public so that the patient can understand. All of that needs a go-between. And the go-between is the fellow of the European Society. So I say, get more interviews here of young people mm-hmm. who have joined or are in it to find out whether they find satisfaction. Mm-hmm. But they are as important as the presidents of our society are.
Thank you for the explanation. How many of you were the first year in the fellowships? Only two or more?
No. The Mutual Admiration Society. I love that term. We had several people who said, okay, we'll do the same thing. There was hesitation, and the hesitation in the 70s was really on this self-aggrandissement, that you seem to wish to push yourself. And that held it back a bit. Many people felt also that they were recognized in their national communities and societies, so why go further? We worked on the European thought, and don't forget that that was also the best period of the growth of the European Union. And so the whole European concept, as it grew, required the fellowships as well. So from the 10 that we had initially, I think within a year we had 200 to 220. Then the slow growth period started because of the factors I've just mentioned. And then after that, and recently, I think it has done very well.
So what did you recommend to join the community in this moment?
This community?
Yes.
Well, in a way, I said, what are the requirements? And I'll repeat them. You have to be somewhere in the profession. You have to have the recognition of your national society. You have to be willing to give time. But what I didn't say, and what you're asking, is that I think it requires a willingness to stand for a principle. You should be in the community, and that is a European community, whether you're Greek or whether you're Iceland or wherever from, to stand for a common idea. We are the profession that determines to a large extent how patients with heart disease are being treated or prevented from having the disease. And I think we should be also the reference in terms of the quality that we deliver. And as members insist on looking at our colleagues, it's a self-regulating mechanism. Don't forget that in the past, universities were stronger than they are now. You were always connected to your university, you stay with the university. Now we make the big open university of cardiology. Mm-hmm. And quality control is terribly important. If the people and the population of Europe were to doubt that we didn't deliver the top quality, it would be damaging, very damaging to our society. And since no one else can give us the quality control, we must give it ourselves. I'm reminded when I talked about quality control of the fellowship with the Association of International Airline Pilots. And I asked, how do you keep the quality? Now, they said, very simple. Once a year we go on a simulator, and it has this plane or that plane, and you have to land it. And of course, we don't have these simulators in cardiology in that way, but the thought behind it was correct. They design a tool, and we have tools right here, and these tools should serve us to test the quality of our people. Like the pilots are tested, we should be tested. And I think therefore the re-examination and the recertification is very much an activity that the fellowship should support. It is quality that counts.
Thank you so much. Thank you for all your comments and your storytelling about all the evolution of the fellowship. I think we could finish our interview giving you thanks for coming and all the comments, bring this document. Thank you so much.
It was nice. It hangs in my office on the wall, and I look at it with great satisfaction as a picture from the past, as if that was me as a young man. And it was a pleasure to bring it. And I don't know how many there are around in the English, but the recognition today comes from many more factors than that. Yes. That was simply to start it off.
Thank you so much.
Modesty. Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks for asking.